Okay, hello class. This is part two of the lecture. We now want to work on perform cost volume profit analysis for multiple product and service companies, right? So we started with one product, figured out how to do it. Now we're going to move on to additional products. So how does the CVP analysis change from companies with multiple products? So you start with the basic profit equation, right? Which is right here. Which we've already gone over. Profit equals total sales minus total variable cost minus fixed co total fixed cost. This can be stated using the following variables, and this is just our legend to help you through in case you haven't remembered them yet. S is selling price per unit. V is variable cost per unit. F is total fixed cost. Q is quantity of units produced and sold. And CM is the contribution margin per unit, which is the selling price minus the variable cost. Assume the company sells two products, product one and product two. Profit equation is the unit CM for product one times the quantity of product one plus the unit CM, meaning the unit contribution margin, unit CM for product two times quantity of product two minus fixed cost, right? So, that equation may throw you off a little bit because sometimes when you see like a math equation on a PowerPoint, maybe it's not doesn't jump out and say, okay, this is how it should be. But in the next few slides, we'll show you how it should actually look like when you're going to do your math equation. So what is the sales mix and why is it important in our analysis? So the sales mix is a proportion of one product sales to total sales. So if I have 100% of total sales and I sell 80 of ABC and 20 of XYZ, then 80% of my sales mix goes to ABC and 20% of my sales mix goes to XYZ. Because most companies sell multiple products that have different selling prices and different variable costs, the break-even or target profit depends on the sales mix. So it depends on how many of ABC you sell versus how many of XYZ. An example that we're going to end up showing in the PowerPoint, it shows you that although our contribution margin may be higher for one product, it depends on what type of hours we have available to allocate that may end up changing what we choose in regards to the sales mix. So when calculating break-even or target profit points, we'll assume that the sales mix will remain the same at different sales levels, right? So that's our assumption. So what information is needed to calculate the break-even point for companies with multiple products? Finding the break-even point in units and sales dollars requires the calculation of two items. Well, you're going to do the same thing that you did before, but you're just going to do it times two. Weighted average contribution margin per unit and weighted average contribution margin ratio, right? So the weighted average contribution margin per unit is just like when we figured out the contribution margin per unit is just S minus V. And the weighted average contribution margin ratio, that's when we're actually going to do the calculation and get that percentage. Last time it was a 0.40 or 40%. So how do we find the weighted average contribution margin per unit? So assume Kayaks for Fun has two products with the following data. The selling price for River is 500. The variable cost is 100. So the contribution margin for River is 400. For the Sea Kayak, the selling price is 600, a little bit more. The variable cost is 450, which is a lot more. And the contribution margin is $150. So just at first glance, you're going to say, hey, it's more profitable for us to create the River Kayak because we're getting $400 worth of contribution margin, which is what is allocated towards fixed costs and our profit, as opposed to the C model, which is only going to contribute $150 to our fixed costs and our profit. But those aren't the only variables involved, so keep your ears open so that you see when the signs come up and say we need to shift left or shift right in business. So the River model represents 60% of total sales volume, and the C model is 40%, right? So 60% of what they sell goes to River, 40% goes to C. The weighted average contribution margin per unit is, it says $300 equals, and we'll see why $300. So it says $400 unit contribution margin, right? Where'd you get the $400 back on that slide before this or prior to this one? That contribution margin for River is $400. $400 times 60% because it's 60% of the sales plus $150, which is $150. That's their contribution margin. $150 a unit contribution margin times the 40%. Right, so if you take 400 and you multiply it by 60, Then you add that number to 150 times 40% or 0.40, then you'll have your $300. So if you don't know, I think everybody knows by now, but if you're multiplying by a percentage, 400 times 0.60, not 60%, 0.60 is the decimal equivalent of 60%, and $150 times 0.40, because that's the decimal equivalent of 40%. And that's how you actually get your weighted average contribution margin per unit. So having calculated the weighted average contribution margin per unit, how do we determine the break-even point or target profit in units? Well, our break-even point equation is total fixed cost plus target profit divided by the weighted average contribution margin per unit, right? So total fixed cost, we know what that is. We get our target profit. We'll know what that is if we're doing for break-even, it's going to be zero, and you divide it by that weighted average contribution margin per unit. So how do we find the weighted average contribution margin ratio? So the calculation, total contribution margin divided by total sales. And you have those numbers given here. So what's our total contribution margin? It's right there, 70,000, 30,000, 125,000, and in total it's 225,000. And then divided by total sales. So what are your total sales? It's up there in the first row. Tax is 100,000, audit is 150,000, consulting is 250,000, the total is 500,000. So those are the numbers, line one and line three, that you're going to be dividing. So says down here, for Amy's accounting service, the weighted average contribution margin ratio is 225,000 total contribution margin, right? Which is right there, divided by 500,000 in total sales. And it is 0.45 or 45%. Now, if you want to get it for the various departments, tax, audit, and consulting, you obviously know that you would just go ahead and take 70,000 and divide it by 100,000 for tax. For audit, you would take 30,000 and divide it by 150,000. And for consulting, you would take 125,000 and divide it by 250,000. But for the total, we have 225,000 divided by 500,000, which gives us 0.45 or 45%. That is your contribution margin ratio. So having calculated the weighted average contribution margin ratio, how do we determine the break-even point or target profit in sales dollars? Well, same equation. Your total fixed cost plus your target profit divided by your weighted average contribution margin ratio. What's your weighted average contribution margin ratio? It is 0.45. So under there, you don't put 4.5, you put 0.45. So total fixed cost plus target profit over 0.45. And then you have plenty of examples in the book that shows you the equation all the way through, and you should be very proficient with that after you try it a few times. So what assumptions do we make when performing the CVP analysis for companies with multiple products? Well, costs can be separated into fixed and variable components. That's an assumption we make. And you know, they say not to make assumptions, but there's certain assumptions that you have to make. I'm sure you assume that the sun would come up today, and you assume that when you go to work that you know, you'd have to work. So there are assumptions that we do have to make. Contribution margin ratio remains constant for each product, segment, or department, and the sales mix remains constant with changes in total sales, right? So that mix is going to remain constant. So, use a sensitivity analysis to determine how changes in the cost volume profit equation affect the profit. So, how is sensitivity analysis used to help managers make decisions? Well, this is how. Sensitivity analysis, also called the what-if analysis, shows how the CVP model will change with changes in any of its variables. For example, fixed cost, variable cost, or sales price. So, if you make a change to the fixed cost, right? Let's just say you lower the fixed cost, you're going to make more money. If the variable cost increases, right, you have to pay more to make more, then your profit is going to decrease. And if your sales price goes up, your profit is obviously going to increase. But does your sales price go up too high and nobody the people no longer want to purchase your product? Things you always have to think about in business. It can be used to answer questions like this. How will profit change if the sales price increases by $30? So just remember these. How will profit change if fixed cost increases by 25%? And how will profit change if sales volume decreases by 35%? So just keep that little nugget in the back of your head. And this is where we look at. You check out the different scenarios, right? So if you look at the scenario and you see here, this is our base case. This is what is current, right? And if the price increases, so if the price increase, so if price goes from $250 to $275, this is what's going to occur. So I want you to look at that on your own, but just remember in this one, the price went up 10%. So 10% of that 250 is 25. So then you have your 275 now. Now you have to see where you end up. But if you look right here at that operating profit, that's 20,000, and now your operating profit went up to 37,500. And this just shows the change. So if the sales volume decreases by 10, so what changes here? So if you're looking at it, and you say, oh, we're not selling 700 units anymore, we're selling 630. So now what's that going to do to our scenario? Well, obviously, if you sell less, then you're going to, make less money, right? So our operating profit goes down to $13,000. That's a drop in $7,000 from the original $20,000 in the base case. And then scenario three, fixed costs decrease 30% and variable costs increase 10%. Well, fixed costs decrease 30%. That's great for the company. That probably means we're going to, garner additional revenue. But variable costs increase by a little bit. Well, if you look at, you take that wash, it is pretty good. Do the equation, but your operating profit goes up 24,500. Had to look a little closer. Don't have my glasses on. All right, so understand how cost structure affects cost, volume, profit, sensitivity analysis. So what is an organization's cost structure? So every company has a specific cost structure. An organization's cost structure is a proportion of fixed and variable cost to total cost, right? So what is the proportion of each? Like, do you have is 80% of your costs allocated towards fixed costs and 20% to variable costs? Just depends. For example, if an organization has $80,000 in fixed costs and $20,000 in variable costs, the cost structure is described as 80% fixed costs and 20% variable costs. Very easy figure to determine and figure out. So what is the organization's operating leverage? Now, this is very interesting. Have to pay close attention because sometimes in some of these managerial accounting things, you can say, oh, well, that means that it should be this way, go left, but it really means that you should go right, so pay close attention. So operating leverage refers to the level of fixed costs within the organization. So how fixed cost heavy is your organization? So companies with a high proportion of fixed costs have high operating leverage. So just picture in your head, high fixed costs, high operating leverage. Now that can be good and can also be bad, and you'll understand as we look to the next few slides. Businesses that have large investments in facilities and equipment generally have a cost structure with high fixed costs and high operating leverage, right? Like an airplane, airplane industry. Businesses that rely on direct labor and direct materials tend to have higher variable costs and lower operating leverage, right? So if it's a restaurant, then they're going to have a lower operating leverage. So why is operating leverage important? Well, there are many reasons. It affects how sensitive profits are to changes in sales volume. If firms with high operating leverage tend to profit more than from increasing sales, meaning that if you have a high operating leverage, once you get to a certain point, that sales in those sales increase incrementally and exponentially. It's like, hey, everything's okay up until 250 sales. Maybe we're losing some money, but past 250, we're making money and making is compounding, and with that high operating leverage, it allows the company to do so. With low operating leverage, it's more consistent. Conversely, firms with high operating leverage lose more from decreasing sales than a firm with low operating leverage. So if a restaurant, if sales go down because it's Christmas and that's just a day that most people are at home, I mean traditionally, but now things have changed, then that's okay with a restaurant. But if you change the amount of sales that are sold, if a company has a higher operating leverage, it's going to affect them immensely. So check it out. This is how it looks. So high operating leverage company and a low operating leverage company. So let's look at what the differences are. So $500,000 in sales, those things are both the same. Then you have $100,000 in variable costs here, and $350,000 in variable costs there. And that is the difference between the two. Higher operating leverage, you have variable costs low, and then lower operating leverage, you have variable costs high. Contribution margin is obviously higher on the higher operating leverage side, but the fixed cost is higher over here, and that's why they have higher operating leverage, and the $50,000 is right there. So we have a few more slides. We will continue on to a lecture for Chapter 6, Part 3 coming up, but it won't be as long as part 1 and part 2. See you shortly.